Hey there guys, it's Amit, you're watching DevDreamer, and this is the complete guide to CSS Flexbox. In this one video, we're going to go through the entire CSS Flexible Layout Module, or CSS Flexbox for short, in a simple step-by-step way, and of course we'll do all that using examples throughout. If you're new to this channel and you like the content, please hit that like and subscribe button down below. Don't forget to turn on notifications as well by hitting the bell. Okay, so let's begin with understanding what CSS Flexbox actually is. Okay, so CSS Flexbox is a relatively new and better way in which we can lay out, position, and align elements within a given container. The purpose of Flexbox is to simplify the process of designing a dynamic or flexible, hence the term flexible box model, responsive layout structure without using things such as CSS float or positioning. So the purpose of CSS Flexbox is to make our lives a lot easier when it comes to positioning and layout, and as you'll see, it's a really, really powerful module. Now, before we have Flexbox, there were four basic ways in which we could lay out our elements. We could use a block layout, which span the width of the whole page. We could use floats. So for example, you could have a text and an image, and you could float the text to the right so that you have the text and the image side by side. We also had position for specific positioning of an element. And finally, this is going way back, we had tables. So literally, you would create a table with its cells and then fill these in with your elements. Okay, so now let's take a look at Flexbox. So here then on this container, we have an example where we're using Flexbox on our container with display flex, and then we're justifying the content within that container by using space evenly. And as you can see, with two simple lines, we've controlled our items by spacing them out evenly, all done using the power of CSS Flexbox. So whenever we want to control items that have been laid out in either a row as we have here, or even a column, and we want to control the space in between those items and how they use up the space when the container grows or shrinks, these are the uses that Flexbox was designed for. Now notice that we have a container and then we have items. CSS Flexbox has container properties that are applied to the actual container, and we've used two of them here, display and justify content. These are examples of container properties. And then we also have item properties in Flexbox that are applied to the items within the container. Let's take a look at what they are. So these are all the Flexbox properties. On the left hand side here we have container properties, and on the right we have item properties. So the container properties are things such as display, flex direction, flex wrap, flex flow, justify content, align items, and align content. And for the item properties we have order, flex grow, flex shrink, flex basis, flex, and align self. And of course we're going to be going through each of these in detail. Okay, so the last thing we need to grasp before digging into some code is the Flexbox main axis and cross axis. Okay, so the flex layout is based upon flex flow directions. To understand this, let's take a look at the following diagram. So let's say we have our flex container because we've set the display of this container to flex, and then automatically any items within that container will become flex items. So inside that we have some items that we've set to lay out in a row. So we've set flex direction to row on this container. That's why our flex items are laid out side by side. So because our flex direction is row, our main axis here will be horizontal, going across like so. And our cross axis will be vertical, running in the opposite direction. If we'd set our flex direction to column, and these items were stacked on top of each other, then our main axis will be vertical, as that's the direction that our items are flowing in. And then the cross axis will be going opposite to that, so in that scenario, the cross axis will be running horizontally. So the cross axis is determined based upon whatever the main axis is, and the main axis is determined by what we set the flex direction to. So to summarize, the main axis is the main direction along which flex items are laid out, and again this depends on the flex direction property, whether it's set to row or column, and then the cross axis is always perpendicular to the main axis. Now what's the point in knowing the main axis and the cross axis of our flex container? Well, knowing this will come in handy when it comes to some of the flex container properties. And speaking of the flex container, let's now dive into some code and explain each container property in detail. We'll then do the same for the item properties, and then finally we'll look at some examples as well. And again, I'll leave timestamps in the description box below for each section. Okay, so let's do this. Okay, so here we are then in our text editor. In the HTML, we have this div with an ID of container, which is this purple container here. And then inside that, we have four divs, each with a class of item, and also class of 1, 2, 3, and 4, respectively. And those are these green items over here. Let's now take a look at our CSS. Okay, so this is just a styling for a container. It has a width of 1,000 pixels and a height of 400 pixels. Okay, so let's go ahead and turn this container into a flex container by setting the display on the container to flex. So this is now a flex container, and any items within the container automatically become flex items. Now notice that as soon as we set the container to flex, our items are laid out in a row. And that's because by default, the flex direction property on a flex container, flex direction, is set to row. Remember, flex direction establishes the main axis for our container. So by default, the main axis is horizontal like this. Now we can change this by setting flex direction to column. Okay, so now our items are stacked on top of each other like this. We can do column reverse to reverse the items. So now it's 4, 3, 2, 1, as opposed to 1, 2, 3, 4. And of course, we can do the same thing for row as well. Okay, let's just set this back to row. And technically, I don't need to declare flex direction to row, as remember, this is the default value of our flex container, but for the purposes of this tutorial, we'll keep it up. Okay, so the next flex container property we're going to look at is flex wrap. And you can probably guess what this does by its name. Flex wrap allows our items to wrap onto a new line. Now, by default, flex wrap is set to no wrap, so that our flex items will not wrap onto a new line. So if we had some more items within here, so let's just save this. Let's go into HTML and add some more items in. Now we have 12. As you can see, the items will continue to be laid out on the same line. Now this isn't infinite, so you can't have 100 items here and expect them to all, you know, squish into this container. They will overflow at some point, so do keep that in mind. But now that we've got some more items, let's go to our flex wrap property again and see what we can do. So we can set this to wrap. And now, as you can see, our items wrap onto a new line. We can also say wrap reverse. And what this does is, rather than wrapping from top to bottom, it wraps from bottom to top. So we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and then the items wrap onto the top, like so. So that's the flex wrap property. Okay, so let's set ours to wrap. And save this, and let's also just get rid of these items as well. Okay. Now the next property is flex flow. Now flex flow won't introduce anything new, because flex flow is simply the shorthand property for flex direction and flex wrap. So with flex flow, you can declare these two, flex direction and flex wrap, on a single line. So ours would be row wrap, like so. And so this is exactly the same as saying this. So we can, if we wanted to, delete these two now because we've declared flex flow instead. But again, for the purposes of this tutorial, I'll just leave them up as well. Now the next flexbox container property is justify content. And of course, you should remember this one from my example earlier on. Now, when you think about justify content, I want you to think about your main axis, because justify content defines how the space along the main axis is used up. By default, this is set to flex start, which is why our items are bunched up at the start here. We can change this to flex end. Okay, that puts them on the end. If we wanted to center our items, we just say center. Are you starting to see the power and the ease of use of flexbox? Again, if you find this video useful, do let me know in the comment section down below, and of course, smash that like and subscribe button as well. Okay, so what else can we do with justify content? Let's say we don't want our items all bunched up in the center here, but we want to make use of the space that we have around our items here by putting some space in between our items. So for that, we just say space between. And now you can see we have space in between our items. Well, let's say we didn't just want space in between our items, we also wanted some space around our items as well. Well, you guessed it, we just changed this to space around. And now you can see we have space not only in between our items, but also around our items as well. Now, if you look carefully here, let's just zoom in. You can see that the spacing in between each item is actually more than the spacing on the outside of our items. Okay, it's the same over here as well. So let's say we wanted these to be spaced out evenly. Well, we simply change this to space evenly. And now you can see the spacing in between our items is exactly the same as our spacing around our items as well. Now do bear in mind that there's no padding placed on this container. Okay, so if we just added some padding of, let's say, 20 pixels, you can see even though we've got justify content set to space evenly, because we've got a padding now on our container, you can see here that the spacing around our items seems to be more than spacing in between. And that's because we need to bear in mind that we have padding on this container as well. Okay, let's just get rid of this padding for now. Okay, the next flexbox container property we're going to look at is align items. Think of align items as the justify content version of the cross axis. So currently our main axis is set to horizontal going across because our flex direction is set to row, and so the cross axis is going to be vertical going down. So align items is all about how we space our items along this cross axis. So currently then it's in the flex start position. However, the default value for align items is actually stretch. Now the reason why these aren't stretching all the way down is because we've actually specified height on our items. Okay, height 80 pixels. If we remove this, you can see now that the items stretch all the way down. Let's just get rid of this and see what else we can do. We can also specify flex end, Okay, now they've been put to the end of the cross-axis. We can say center, and now our items are centered along the cross-axis. And for the last align items value here, let's say that we had an item with larger text so that the items are no longer aligned according to their baseline. So currently, if we take a look at this, let's just zoom in, we can see that the items all line up. So the baseline of the 1, 2, the 3, and the 4. Let's just go to our HTML, and let's change the fourth item here to a H1 instead. Okay, so that now you can see items 1, 2, and 3 are aligned according to their baseline, but number 4 isn't. So now let's see what we can do with align items. We can say align items, baseline, and now each of the items is aligned according to their baseline. So the baseline value will align flex items along their contents baseline. Okay, so let's get rid of this H1, set it back to our normal 4, save that. And let's set align items to, let's go for center. So that is the align items property. And that leads us on to the final flex container property, which is align content. Now align content has no effect when there's only one line of items like we have here. So let's go ahead and add some more items to our container. Okay, so now we've got 12, and you can see that they span over two lines. So now let's see what the align content property does. Okay, since we now have more items that have wrapped onto a new line, we now have to think about how we distribute the space not only between these items, but also around them as well. Now these items and these items collectively make up our content, hence the term align content. So let's say we wanted our content pushed up to the start. We simply say, you guessed it, flex start. And I can see that our content is now at the start. And of course, we can specify flex end as well as center, space around, space between. Okay, so now we've got space between our items, but not around. And finally, space evenly as well, so that there's an equal amount of space in between our items, but also around them as well. So those are all the flex container properties. We haven't even touched the items yet, and look at how powerful and easy that was to lay out our content exactly as we wanted it, especially with the simple semantic property values like center or space around, space evenly. Really, really powerful. Okay, so now let's move on to look at the flex item properties, and then we'll look at two examples using what we've learned. We'll build a game card using Flexbox, and we'll create a navigational menu with Flexbox as well. Okay, so we've reset our code, and this is what our container and items look like. Pretty much the same setup as before, where we had our container, our four items, and each item has a class of either 1, 2, 3, or 4. Okay, the first Flexbox item property we're going to look at is order. Now, by default, our items are laid out according to the source order. So we've got 1, 2, 3, and 4, because in our HTML, that's what we've specified, 1, 2, 3, and 4. But the order property enables us to control and change the order of the items. Now, by default, order property is set to 0. So here we're just selecting each item 1, 2, 3, and 4, and we set the order to 0 on all of them. But if we go ahead and change these, so let's change item 1 to 1, number 2 to 10, number 3 to 5, and for number 4, let's go for something big, 100. And now if we take a look at a container, the order has changed. We've got 1, 3, 2, and 4. And the way this works is, whatever has the highest order gets pushed further towards the end. Whatever has the lowest number is at the start. So our item of number 1 has an order of 1, and so it's at the start. The second highest order is number 5, okay, item 3, which is why number 3 comes next. Then it's number 2 with an order of 10, which is why number 2 is in the third position. And then finally, item number 4 has an order of 100, which is why it's at the end there. Now you can also specify minus numbers as well. So if we gave item 4 an order of minus 100, this is now lower than 1, which is why 4 now becomes the first item. It's also important to note that these numbers are relative to each other. So let's just set all these to 1. So we've got 1, 2, 3, and 4. If we set them all to 10, you'll see that they remain in positions 1, 2, 3, and 4 because the orders are relative to each other. Okay, so that's the order property. Let's just go ahead and set these back to 0. The next property we're going to look at is flex grow. Now with flex grow, we can tell our items how they should grow to use up the remaining space. So let's take a look at our container. We've got our items, and then we've got this extra space here. So flex grow is all about how our items should grow to use this extra space. So for example, if the extra space here was 400 pixels, how should our items grow to use up this extra space of 400 pixels? Now by default, the value for flex grow is 0, which means don't grow at all. So let's just go ahead and add flex grow 0 to our items. Okay, so they've all got a flex grow of 0, and as expected, our items are not growing at all to use up this extra space. Let's actually go ahead and set all of these to 1. And you can already see something's starting to happen there on our container. Now, when we set flex scroll to 1, it basically means set each item to grow equally so that the extra space is distributed evenly to each of them. And so if we have a look, our items have now grown equally to use up the remaining space so that they now fill up the container. In other words, they've all grown at an equal rate of 1. So now they're all the same size. If we set one of these to 2, let's just do it on the number 2 here, so flex scroll 2. Okay, so now items 1, 3, and 4 have a flex scroll of 1, and item 2 has a flex scroll of 2. And as you can see, item number 2 is visibly bigger than items 1, 3, and 4. And what this means is that item 2 will take up twice as much as the space than items 1, 3, and 4. Now, this is very important to know. What this doesn't mean is that item 2 will have double the width of items 1, 3, and 4. You can see that although item 2 is bigger than 1, 3, and 4, it's not double the size. And so it can be a bit confusing, but here's how to remember it. The remaining space that we have, items 1, 3, and 4, because they have a flex scroll of 1 each, should all get an equal amount of spacing. So the amount of spacing that they get should all be the same, but item 2 should get twice as much. Okay, so that is the flex grow property. Okay, let's just go ahead and set these back to 0, so that our items are not growing at all. And now the next property we're going to look at is flex shrink. And flex shrink, as you can probably guess by the name, tells our items at what rate they should shrink. So for this example, let's just go ahead and add some more items into our container. Okay, so now we have 12 items altogether, and as you can see, our items have gone smaller to fit into this container. Now, the default value for flex shrink is 1, so let's just go ahead and add that to our items. Okay, so now items 1, 2, 3, and 4 each have a flex shrink of 1. We won't bother adding it to items 5 to 12 because by default they all have flex shrink of 1 anyway. Okay, flex shrink with a value of 1 basically means that all our items shrink at an even rate, so that if they ever do need to shrink, as they need to in this example here, they all remain the same size. As you can see, items 1 to 12 are all exactly the same size. So the rate at which the items shrink is what flex shrink is all about. So let's say we wanted item number 3 to shrink faster than the rest. Well, let's just change flex shrink on item number 3 to 2. And as you can see, item number 3 is now smaller than the rest. Just zoom in to show you. Now you can also say, well actually, I don't want item number 1 to shrink at all. Well, we just simply set flex shrink on item 1 to 0. Now you can see item number 1 retains its width and all the other items shrink. Okay, so that's the flex shrink property. Okay, so let's just go ahead and set flex shrink to 0 on all our items. So we don't want any of these to shrink at all. And let's go ahead and remove our other items there, so we're just back to the 4. Okay, the next flex item property we're going to learn is flex basis. So think about flex basis as the size of our items. If we haven't specified a flex basis, like we haven't done here, then the size of our items falls back to the width. And if no width is specified, then the size of the item falls back to the item's content. So let's make sense of all this. So in our example, we haven't specified a flex basis, but we have specified a width. So let's just go to our item class. Okay, so you can see we've got width 150 pixels. So each of these items is 150 pixels in width. But if we didn't specify a width, then the width of the items would actually be the size of the content. So now let's put the width back on. And let's specify on all of our items a flex basis. So let's say flex hyphen basis, and let's go for 200 pixels. Our items are now using flex basis, so they're all 200 pixels, as opposed to the width. So we can actually just get rid of this now, we don't need this, as our items are now being sized according to this flex basis that we've set here. Now, what you need to know about flex basis is that flex basis is limited by max width and min width. In other words, if we were to give our items a max width of, let's say, 50 pixels, you can see that each item now has a max width of 50 pixels. So what's happening here is, although we've set a flex basis to 200 pixels, before our items can grow to 200 pixels, they stop at 50 pixels because we have a max width of 50 pixels. So flex basis is limited by max width. It's also limited by min width. So let's just get rid of this and say min width. And let's set this to 500 pixels. And so now each item is 500 pixels in width. So you see that max width and min width override flex basis. So what's the point of flex basis? Well, when we have an overflow like this, flex basis comes to the rescue. Because if we set flex basis to 500 pixels and remove this, and also set flex shrink to 1, you can see now we don't get that same problem. The items couldn't grow to 500 pixels because there wasn't enough space, and so they shrink to fit. If the container or the viewport did grow, then the items will also grow as well, up to 500 pixels. So flex basis is useful because it doesn't overflow our items. Okay, so that's the flex basis property. Next, we have the flex property. Now flex is a shortened property for flex grow, flex shrink, and flex basis. So let's go ahead and just comment all of these out here. And let's remove flex basis as well. And now we can declare flex grow, flex shrink, and flex basis on a single line by saying flex, and then the order is grow, and then it's shrink, and then finally it's flex basis. Now by default this is set to 0, 1, and auto. So let's say we wanted our items to grow at a rate of 1. We don't want them to shrink, so we set this to 0, and we want each item to be 200 pixels. Okay, now we get the exact same thing here, but we've declared everything on a single line using flex. And that leads us onto our final flex item property, which is align self. Align self allows us to specify any single item and align just that item. So for example, let's go ahead and target item number 3. And let's set the align self to, let's go for flex end. And as you can see, we've targeted just item number 3, and now item number 3 is aligned to the end. So that's the align self property. And with that, guys, we've gone through every flex container property and every flex item property. So let's now use what we've learned to build two small things. Let's start with the game card. Okay, so first then, let's use Flexbox to create this little game card. In our HTML, we have this div with an ID of image container, which is this top section here. And then we have a div with a class of info, which is this bottom text section here. Let's now remove our styles and then build this back up. Okay, so first then, let's work on this top image container. So this is what we want it to look like, and this is what we've got. So first of all then, let's just drop in our non-flex styles. Okay, so we've given it a background of this linear gradient, width and height of 400 pixels, margin 0 auto to put it into the middle, and then a border radius of 8 pixels on the top, left, and right. Now with this first example, one of the things I wanted to show you was how to center an element with Flexbox. So first, we're going to give our image container a display of flex. Okay, so now this container is a flex container, and this image becomes a flex item, and we want to move this flex item across to the center. Now remember, by default, the flex direction is row, and so the main axis is going across like this. So if we want to move our item into the center across, we need to target justify content, and we say center, so that's now in the middle. And now we also want to align this vertically, which means we're targeting the cross axis, and to target that we say align items center. And now our flex item is perfectly centered inside of our flex container. Let's now work on this bottom section here. So remember, this is what we want it to look like. Once again, let's just go ahead and add in our non-flex styles. Okay, so here we've given it a width of 400 pixels to match the width of our container. We've given it a height of 100 pixels, we've given it this black gradient, and we've also specified a border radius of 8 pixels for the bottom, right, and left. Now first of all, black text on a black background doesn't work, so let's just go ahead and set this to white text. And let's go ahead and give this info box a display of flex. And now you see each of our items is laid out in a row. But we want these to stack on top of each other, so we're going to set flex direction to column. Now you see they stack on top of each other. I also want some spacing around our items, so I'm going to say justify content, space around. And remember, the main axis is now vertical because we set flex direction to column, which is why justify content is spacing out our images vertically. And finally, to align this horizontally into the center, we target align items center. And now you see we have our game card using Flexbox. Okay, so now let's look at creating a navigational menu with Flexbox. So this here is what we want to create. So we've got our logo on the left, and then on the right we've got our links here nice and spaced out. In the HTML we have a header. Now this header is going to be our flex container, and inside that we've got a div with the ID of logo, and so that we've got the image, and then we've got a nav tag with our links in there. So these two are going to be the flex items. This is going to be the flex container. Let's go ahead and take a look at the CSS, and let's see what this looks like without the Flexbox styling. Okay, so this is what we've got. Now before we begin, you might notice that we've already got some spacing here on the side, and that's because this header has some padding applied to it. So if you just remove this, you'll see now our items are flush against the side. So that's the reason why we've got some space in there already. Okay, so the first thing we want to do is we want to turn this into a flex container by setting the display to flex. Let's set our flex direction and flex wrap on this by using the shorthand property of flex flow. Okay, so we're going to go for flex flow, roll, no wrap. And I want some space in between our items. Remember, we want this. Okay, so we've got them on either side. So I'm actually going to go for justify content space between. Now I've got space in between our items. And finally, let's get these items centered on the cross axis. So we'll say align items center. Now you can see they're centered on the cross axis. Okay, let's now move on to our items. And the first thing we want to do is just apply an outline to each of these so we can just see what we're working with. Okay, so outline of 1 pixel solid gray on the logo, and the same for the navigation items as well. And I want this logo to take up 40% of our header. So I'm going to set the flex basis on the logo to 40%. And for the nav items, I want this to be 60%. Okay, so this is what we've got. Now this nav tag with the A-links inside, I'm actually going to set this to a display of flex as well. And finally, you can see we've got our links, but also we've got some spacing here that they're not using up. We've got this extra free space here. We want our items to grow so that they use up that space. So we're just going to say flex grow 1. And now you can see they all grow to use up that space equally. Finally, let's go ahead and remove our outlines. And there we go. This is what we wanted. And that's what we've got. Okay guys, so that's how to use Flexbox to build a simple navigational menu. Once again guys, if you found this video helpful and useful, please smash that like button down below, hit the subscribe button as well. Don't forget to hit the notification bell so you're notified as soon as new content goes up. Do let me know in the comment section down below how you plan on using Flexbox, and also what you liked about the video and how it's helped you. Okay guys, so that's it for this lesson. Get practicing and I'll see you on the next one.